I'm Charlotte Fantelli, the director, producer and somewhat writer of Journey to Le Mans. The film itself chronicles Jota's season 2014. So that was the ELMS, around at the WEC and through to Le Mans itself. The story couldn't have been scripted. It was a remarkable turn of events from their very first outing at Silverstone all the way through. It keeps the drama up until the very, very end, which I don't want to give away, but motorsport fans will probably already know what that is. I've always had a massive passion for motorsports. Ever since I can remember, really, it's excited me. And I've been lucky enough to be in the pits with the drivers and the mechanics and the engineers. And for me, endurance motorsport was really the pinnacle of that, both in terms of what it takes from a physical side of it, but also from the sort of mechanical engineering side of it. To me, endurance and sports cars really is where my passion lies. So the challenges really were ensuring that we came second to the race, because obviously they're there to do a job and they don't want a camera to get in the way of their job, whether that's the small little cameras that we have on their car, influencing weight, influencing aero, or whether that's the bigger cameras that we're carrying around in a live pit lane. So there's always got to be two people at any one time. A lot of the time it was myself. I was ACing as well as other things to my wonderful directors of photography, making sure that they were aware of their surroundings, putting my hands upon them so that if I needed to drag them out of the way, whether that be because the fuel guy needs to get in the fuel pump in the car, or whether that's because there was an issue. Obviously, those sort of things you have to be very, very aware of. And I've got to say, the FIA, fantastic at briefing you all the time, keeping you very much aware of your surroundings and what you're actually doing. I have to say, I think there's a magic about it. I think there's something in the air at Le Mans that you can't quite describe. And if we've captured a little bit of that Le Mans magic, I don't know, maybe it's the fact that people are up for 24, 36, 48 hours at a time. You're all a bit surreal. It's all a bit dreamlike. The noise, the smell, the amount of different cars on the track, to me that makes it really exciting. You know, the amount of overtaking, the amount of discipline, you have to be alert 24 hours solid, and it's just magic. I hope that we've captured a real glimpse into what it takes to be a team. I think more than anything, yes, we focus a lot on the drivers, but we also focus on the people behind the scenes, you know, the mechanics, the guys who are up for 36, 40 hours at a time, pouring their heart and their soul into every minute of this 24-hour race and the season. And I just hope that we've managed to capture that and do the motorsport fan proud.
Well, I think if you're a motorsport fan, and or a sports fan in general, I think it should be able to give you a good insight into how these professional teams work, and give you a little bit more than what you'd usually see on the television. Because I think in motorsport, obviously there's a lot of money spent on it. There's a lot of secrets that are involved in it, and so generally the public is sort of kept out of the inner workings of the team a little bit more, because it's competitive and everyone's, you know, paying a lot of money to get that edge. So I think to have this documentary, this sort of insider documentary into exactly what goes on in the build up to the race and the actual race itself, should hopefully be interesting for the motorsport fan, and maybe even people that aren't interested in motorsport. Well, it's a whole Formula One season in one race. It's the biggest test of man and machine, I think, in the world. It's one of the highest attended sporting events in the world, let alone a motorsport event. So the atmosphere when you turn up to Le Mans is just something that I've never experienced anywhere else. And I think when people go there for the first time, they realize why it's so special. And like I say, having 24 hours, a whole Formula One season in one race, it really sorts the men out from the boys, and you have to prepare so well for it that only the best sort of get to the end. And I think the fans appreciate that as much as the competitors. Well, it's my first time there this year, so it's a little bit of just going to have to see how it goes. And one thing that the team said to me was, don't get involved with all the razzmatazz during the week, because you can turn up to, you can wake up on race morning and feel absolutely exhausted, and the race hasn't even begun yet, and you still have a 24-hour race to do. So even on Saturday morning, trying to keep myself out the limelight as much as I could, I still felt pretty tired. I was like, blimey, I've got a whole race to do here. I mean, on the grid, with the, when the French national anthem was going off, and every, you know, 250,000 fans singing was pretty special. And then once the race has started, it's actually, in a way, quite, it's quite regimented and quite lonely for a driver, because you get in, you drive the car, you get out, have a massage, have some food, and then you put straight in the motorhome to relax and sleep. And you don't actually really see the other drivers until the end of the race, which is quite crazy considering it's a, it lasts a whole day. And then for me, in my last sort of stint in the car, I went from third to almost into the lead, and then I sort of had to get out and watch Ollie do the last hour and a half, and that was by far the worst part of the whole race, because I'd done everything I could do and the team had done everything they could do, and now it was all just down to Ollie just bringing the car home safely and the car not giving up in the last hour or so. So to like I say, that last bit was almost the worst feeling that I've had ever in motorsport, because it's just, you're just praying that the car is going to hold on. So to make it to the end was amazing, and then to stand on the podium and have maybe 80 or 90,000 of the fans run onto the circuit and into the pit lane and be all there to be cheering you on was pretty amazing as well. Something I won't forget for a long time. Well, obviously, you know, you go racing to win, so I obviously turned up to the race wanting to win, but I thought realistically a podium was probably more realistic, and I think that was achievable. I thought the car was strong enough, I thought the driver lineup was strong enough, and I thought the team had done a good enough job in the preparation. To go there and win is, like I say, I thought that if everything went right, we might have a possible chance, but obviously now I've won it on my first attempt, I want to go back there and win it more and more, and become a multiple champion and try and follow in my footsteps of my manager, like Alan McNish, who's won it three times, and etc. So I guess now I've had a taste of the bug, I want to sort of come back and do it over and over again. Yeah, you know, just want to thank them so much. When the national anthem was going, to see all the British flags flying and everyone singing along, in, you know, in a French country, in a French town, was just amazing. So it was amazing the next day, actually driving back, just seeing all the fans and everyone, you know, wishing me well and everything like that. So hope to see them all down there again next year and make the atmosphere even better than it was this year.
You know, I think it's going to tell the real kind of passion challenge of racing at Le Mans. You know, it's the biggest race out there. It's the hardest, the most challenging race. And you know, it's got a real history, and you know, in the motorsport, it's just a phenomenal experience to race at Le Mans. So you know, hopefully, the film, I haven't seen the film, but you know, hopefully, I'm sure it's going to tell the story of what the team, what the drivers go through in preparing for Le Mans, and obviously what happens at Le Mans. So in the end, but it, you know, I'm really looking forward to seeing the film. My journey was quite a lot shorter to Le Mans. You know, I raced with Jota last year. It was my first year in sports cars, and then this year, unfortunately, the drive I had didn't happen in the end. So I got a last-minute call-up to come back and race at Le Mans with Jota, and that was, you know, something that was an amazing experience. You know, this team, I love racing with this team, and it was something that I'll always remember. You know, it's massive. It's a real. It's the biggest race of the year. The best teams, the best drivers are all there in sports cars. So, you know, for Jota as a small British team, and also for Simon, you know, he's come from a few years ago. He was not even racing. So, to start racing, you know, a couple of years ago, and to have worked his way up to racing at Le Mans, and then to now this year to standing on the top step is a phenomenal achievement for Jota and for Simon. So, you know, I'm just glad that I was able to be part of the team and that won. And it was a phenomenal experience. I mean, physically, Le Mans is it's not the hardest circuit out there. It's got a long straight, so you get a lot of rest. But obviously, you do long stints in the car, so it's you spend up to 4 hours in the car, and a lot of the stints are you do 3 or 4 stints through the race of that distance. So it's really about a test of endurance, a test of mentally. It's very, very tough. It's a test of concentration. Being aware of what's around you. There's a lot of traffic. Racing at night is really very tough on your eyes. So it's it is very, very physically and mainly mentally demanding. To also the sleep deprivation. You know you don't get much sleep through the race. So it's a real challenge, unlike any other race really, to have to get back in the car multiple times. So you know, I think that preparation that you do beforehand is really important. You know, if you don't prepare, you will struggle. And certainly, you know, keeping fit keeps the body fit, but also keeps the mind fit. And it's a tough experience, but it's one that is the most rewarding experience when you're able to cross the line, and especially when you're able to cross the line in first place. I think it's it's very it's a different challenge. In terms of the time you spend in the car, racing at night is obviously different to a Formula One, but I think also the fact that the sleep and getting back in the car, it's quite a different experience. But it's about keeping consistent pace through the traffic as well. You know, you never get many clear laps. You constantly have other cars, GT cars, LMP1 cars, and it's about not losing time when those cars are around you. So it's a very strategical race. It requires a lot of concentration and a lot of thought. So it's the toughest and the most demanding races out there. Obviously the rain at the start, keeping out of trouble there was a lot of cars crashed in the rain, so that was after one lap in my stint. I did my first lap out and then it started raining, so yeah, just keeping out of trouble there. I think then through the night, it went quite cold in the night, so just being quick in those cold conditions, which we were, and we were able to come back through the field. And then obviously the final couple of stints with Harry closing the gap to P2, and then I took over the car in P2 with just over an hour and a half to go, and to able to take the lead after that final pit stop. I think I pushed as hard as I could on that final stint, and was able to come out 1 second ahead of the TDS car, which obviously gave us the lead and put us in the strongest position. And from there we were able to control the race and bring the car home for the team, and for Simon and for Harry.
Who or what was it that inspired you to be a race driver?
It was my dad, actually. So, you know, he was a big motorsport fan himself. He took me to the Grand Prix when I was younger, and I started watching motorsport from a young age, I started in kart racing when I was 8 years old, and kind of worked my way up through karting. I won 2 British kart championships, just me and my dad working together. And really, we've worked hard to get to where we are. And, you know, I worked my way up the single-seater ladder. Obviously, had the dream to be in Formula One and still do. But Le Mans is, you know, another race that I have a really strong dream for. You know, I followed Le Mans for the last couple of years. And it's one of the biggest races. And it's the one I want to win the most. And that's the one that I want to win outright. Obviously, this is it was great to do it with a British team and British teammates. I think Le Mans is it's a worldwide race. It's seen all over the world, and you know, if you ever get a chance to race at Le Mans, just take it, because it's such an amazing experience just to compete there, and to stand on the podiums, an even better experience.
The motorsport fans, obviously, you know, the guys love Le Mans, and they'll take it, you know, it'd be like being in a condensed Le Mans, so they're going to love it. And for the people who don't really know much about motor racing, I'm hoping that they'll take away a story of, you know, if you really put your heart into something, you can do quite well, not only with, you know, my story and Jota's story with the win, but also with Charlotte's story of actually, you know, taking an idea and making it into a film which premieres in Leicester Square. It's a huge achievement. Every big as an achievement as us winning at Le Mans. The most memorable moment for me in winning Le Mans, well, two actually, so when Ollie crossed the line and we knew we'd won, that was something else, because it's all that tension that you've had for the last 23 hours and 59 minutes then just disappears and you can enjoy it. And also, yeah, being up on the podium, just walking out and seeing everyone, that just blows you away. That's, don't care how many times you do it, that's pretty special. In terms of the low points, obviously the crash at Silverstone, that wasn't too good. And then, I suppose the end of the season, you know, we really should have won the championship, and, you know, I had a lock-up and skidded on and lost us some time, and that was actually what cost us the championship in retrospect. So, for me, probably standing on the podium at Estoril was about the low point, because I knew, well, I knew what I'd done, I knew how annoyed I was with myself, so, yeah.
The Silverstone crash was rather spectacular. Can you talk a little bit about just the experience of surviving something like that?
Yeah, I knew what was going to happen. You know, obviously, after I'd got back on the track, I knew the car was going to spear. I knew where the wall was. I kind of knew everything that was going to happen, and just managed to get my hands off the steering wheel as I went in, which, looking at the footage, was a bloody good job. And then I thought, this is going to hurt, and it did hurt a lot. And then I passed out, and then I woke up, and it was more scary before I hit the wall than it was afterwards. You know, once I knew I was all right, it was all right. And then you kind of put up with a concussion, and you can't see straight for a couple of weeks. But then it was very much a matter of getting on with it, because we had Spa like the week later or a couple of weeks later. So I didn't really get much time to think about it. And then obviously subsequent to that, we had races and we had practice and then we had Le Mans and all the good stuff happened. So yeah, I've not thought too much about it since, really. Everybody brings something different, you know. As you know, Bob, who just works harder than anybody I've ever met in my life, you know, he's just incredible, and you'll meet him in the film. And to all the other guys, you know, they all play such an important role, and it's very difficult to overstate how important they are. And a really good example is Roland, who does the refueling. You know, on our last stop, we were only about 4 or 5 seconds ahead. And if Roland had missed the refueling or made a mess up of it, that would have been it. It would have cost us Le Mans. But it doesn't look anything when you see it in the film, and he just puts the refueling rig on and he takes it off. So everybody, and it's similarly the guys who are doing the wheels up, to everybody, you know, the data engineers, the engineers, anybody messes up or does anything wrong, that's it, costs us a result.
Stuart Keasley, Director of Photography for Journeys to Le Mans. Well, the challenges, there are quite a few challenges, really. I mean, you had to integrate yourself with the racing team without getting in their way. That's quite a hard thing. So the most important thing for them is to stay safe and win the races. We have to integrate our camera team within that, to get the shots but not getting their way, and the other teams as well. So keeping ourselves safe is a big challenge. Just running a 24-hour race on the Le Mans race itself, that is extreme. So trying to run a camera team across 24 hours to capture all the angles we wanted to keep the story flowing, and again not getting the racing team's way, that's hard work as well. Just trying to follow focus on a car doing 200 miles an hour coming towards you around a straight, and keep it in focus. That's not so easy either, really. So it's quite a few challenges there to work with. So we filmed the vast majority on FS700 cameras with Odyssey 7Q back-end recorders. So shooting a lot of 2K slow-mo, a lot of RAW. That was our main cameras. Then the onboard cameras, we tried to get something very lightweight that wouldn't affect the performance of the car, wouldn't get in the way of the drivers, would also run for 24 hours. That's quite hard work as well. That's really it in terms of technology. That's pretty much it. The majority of the film was done on 700 with 7Qs, so the grading, the base footage was all very much the same. We did get in footage from the OB truck. A lot of the aerial stuff came in. We had, again, the onboard cameras are very low-grade cameras, a bit of time-lapse as well. So it does, you are bringing in different sources, different types of, OB's got a very rich feel to the colours, we've got a very cinematic feel. So it does present a bit of a challenge to get them all matching up in the same way. But that's the job of the graders back in the edit suite, so that's their magic they run. I stay away from that, that's what they do, and they've done a great job as well. So, well, Le Mans is an event, it's huge. You know, you've got a 250,000 people come to one place, one event for one 24-hour race. But the whole run-up to that, you've got the 7 day beforehand, all the preparation, the scrutineering, the test driving, the engineering. And then to be there, there were that many cars in one place at one time to run that sort of speed along that sort of size track. There's nothing else like it in the world. It's an amazing endurance race that it doesn't just try the racer's ability. It tries the car performance, the car's ability to stay in the track. The marshals have to work themselves to the bone. The whole event itself, to get that many people in one place safely in a wear game without anybody getting injured, is a mammoth event. And just to finish it is an achievement. To win it, of course, is just fantastic. I hope they'll come away getting a real sense of what it's like to be a part of a team. Not just Le Mans itself, but the whole run-up to Le Mans, what it takes to get there, what it takes to train for Le Mans, the challenges you face along the way. So, yeah, we had a number of hurdles and ups and downs before we even got to Le Mans itself. So hopefully it just shows them that it's not just about throwing a big pot of money into a bank account and spending money. You have to try really hard, train really hard, and really focus what you're doing to get out the other end, finishing it. And again, you know, to win it is just the ultimate. But that's a dream, not a hope.